Hello, and welcome everyone. This conference jointly organized by the Center for International Intellectual Property Studies and the European Audiovisual Observatory on the topic of enforcement, copyright enforcement in the online world. So as you know, this event is organized in the context of the Rendezvous Européen de Strasbourg, organized by the Pôle Européen d'Administration Publique, which will be an event that takes place the entire week around the topic of European values. What are the European values? And also has the position, the purpose to position Strasbourg actually as a major player for the European construction. So when the organizers of that conference contacted us in asking us if we were interested in organizing an event in the context of the Rendezvous Européen, I think we didn't hesitate a second to say yes. And together with the European Audiovisual Observatory, by the way, I would like to thank Susanne, Nikoltchev as executive director and her team also for the enthusiasm that they have put in organizing this together with us. We thought that this would be an excellent opportunity to actually join forces and do an event together. And this has actually several reasons. First, and this might sound trivial to recall that, but in this moment of Euroscepticism, it might still be important to tell you that both organizations share the same interest for the European construction, and both have the ambition to participate to the elaboration of sound policies through serious studies, with serious research, and to provide expertise for policy making. We at CEIPI, we are following very closely any legislative initiative in the field of IP at EU level, and we often very closely work with policymakers, with the European Parliament, of course, located here in Strasbourg, with the Council of Europe, but also with the European Commission. We issue policy papers on almost every directive or regulation that is proposed. And in the context of today's discussion, you might be interested to know that we're going to issue a position paper on the directive proposal, at least one of the aspects of that directive proposal, tomorrow or in the next couple of days. You might be aware that we already organized an event in Strasbourg with the Vice President of the European Commission, Mr. Ansip. It was last fall. And at that time, the proposals were not public, so he accepted to discuss them with us. And we are particularly happy and honored that he accepted our invitation today to discuss the concrete proposals that are on the table. The other reason why we thought it would be a great idea to join forces with the Observatory is because we actually realized that recently we were both working on separately but almost simultaneously on similar issues and publishing papers and studies on copyright enforcement online located a few meters from each other in Strasbourg, and that it would make much sense to join forces to actually present our views in the same event, and to show also how much expertise is present here in Strasbourg on matters relevant for the IP framework of European law. And we wanted to draw attention through this event to the following. Strasbourg is not only a European capital for institutions, but can also serve as a major think tank when it comes to the future of intellectual property law, in particularly today, copyright law. And lastly, let me say a few words on the topic and how we structured this event. So we chose the topic of copyright enforcement in the online world. As I said, we work both on the same issue. However, you might say that we didn't choose the most easy topic. It's one of the most complex topic in copyright law. And why is it so? Well, of course, you know that large-scale copyright infringements on the internet have been constant for numbers of years, whether by means of file sharing, through peer-to-peer sites, or more recently, through streaming. And that has been facilitated by the difficulty, actually, of enforcing the exclusive right in a technical environment that is permanently changing. And also, I mean, the phenomenon is not new. We have seen that in the past. And copyright has always had to face with changes in technology, with the phonogram, radio, television, recording devices for works, tape recorders, video recorders, etc., etc., reprography. Every time the copyright system had to adapt, and it did. What is different this time, it's maybe the extent of the phenomenon due to the facility of reproducing copyrighted works in a digital environment in a quality now equal to the original and with the possibility to disseminate it widely in the entire world at zero cost. And you know that as a reaction, various strategy has been adopted by legislators and by right holders in litigation over the last 10 years. And let's say they all failed. At least they didn't have the success that was expected. And that is certainly why we have that topic now on the table for the copyright reform. As the directive proposal has included one article in the text, Article 13, that deals in particular with the role, and I quote, information society service provider in the enforcement of copyright online. Now, when I say that, you immediately see where this can be a very complex undertaking. Information society service provider. Well, that says it all, actually. It's not only dealing about copyright infringement, but also with very complex competing issues, competing values sometimes, that are central to our information society, such as freedom of information, freedom of expression, privacy issues, neutrality, and other important aspects. And all the European courts that were confronted with these questions and with the delicate issue of copyright enforcement online, all of them have very clearly underlined that there's always the need to strike a balance of interest in order to secure that all the values, all the European core values of our legal system are safeguarded in the enforcement process. And that is why we thought it would be crucial to put around the same table in this very close format members of and the highest representatives of the European Commission, the European Parliament, the Council of Europe, judges from the European Court on Human Rights, which is next door, representatives of creators, and also IP scholars to discuss this very complex topic from all the different angles. And we were very surprised to see that all have straightforward accepted this invitation without fearing of, put themselves a little bit in danger, because of course it's a sensitive issue. And therefore, I would like to warmly thank all the speakers that have accepted to join the discussion. And I look very much forward to it. And without further ado, I pass the word to Susanne.
Thank you, Christophe. I also like to welcome on behalf of the European Audiovisual Observatory to this event here on the premises of the Council of Europe, which is home to the observatory, even so we are not in this building. We are in another building in the village of Berger, not close, not far from here, but we have regular meetings here. And I just want to add to the words of Christophe, not a lot, because he has well explained how this came about and has rightfully pinpointed to the common interest and the common work. But as things are, I therefore need to stress a little bit the differences. Because all things being equal, they are still not entirely equal, and it's important for you so that you understand our interest in this event and also our contribution to it. First of all, you will not be able to see any position paper of the observatory. Not today, not ever. That's very important for us. We do not have any positions. We are completely neutral, apolitical, if you so want. And that explains our role in this, and thereby I think we supplement each other very well in this regard. We are there to facilitate the discussion. As Christophe has explained, it's a very complex matter, and you can very easily get it wrong. It's very difficult to get it right. But a prerequisite to get it right is to know what you're really talking about, and to think of even issues that might not be obvious, but that should be already thought alongside right now. That's where the observatory kicks in. That's where we have a strong role. And I want also to highlight that there's another difference between our institutions. We are not academic setting at all, even though, of course, we try to have also very analytical minds and to put things in context, as you will see. But our context is rather much more the reality. It's the link to the industry. The observatory was set up to provide transparency in the audiovisual sector to help the European industry foremost. We are an international organization with 42 members, member states. This includes, by the way, Morocco, actually 41 member states, and one other member, which is the European Union. So the European Union is a member of the observatory, and this is also quite something that you should know. We are getting our input for what we should do from an advisory committee, and I'm very pleased that two members of the advisory board, notably the chair of the advisory board, Johannes Studinger, is with us. He represents Unimay, so the union. So you see, we are also looking into really very practical, very concrete consequences for the industry, but also Cecile Despin, who is with the SAA and is one of the panelists later on. So thank you. In conjunction with the words of Christophe, to everybody who came to make this possible, thank you also to CEIPI and the team of Christophe to have worked so well on making this possible. And I think you have heard enough now of introduction, and therefore we should really dive into the matter right away. With the first presentation coming actually from a colleague of mine, this is Maja Cappello, who is the head of the Department for Legal Information. And she has joined the observatory a little over 2 years ago. And what is also interesting for you to know, she is quite a practitioner. That before that she had worked 16 years for AGCOM. And if I'm not mistaken, AGCOM has the regulatory power on online copyright enforcement. So it was not at the observatory that she discovered the issue on which she will talk right now. And as a classic observatory opener, her goal will be to give you the context of all the various issues that are really touched when we talk about copyright enforcement. So Maja, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Susanne. Thank you, Christophe. And thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for being here. And I will try to guide you through a little bit of setting the scene exercise. So you will not hear about specificities or technicalities on copyright enforcement in practice from me. I am sure this will come up later. So since I have the privilege of opening, I will take it a little bit broader, and I will start to answer a question, a very basic one, which I think we should never forget. Why is this important? Why is copyright enforcement important, and what makes it so special in the online world? This, I think, should be the setting before we start to discuss anything very precisely. And here you see, I will not bombard you with slides, it's just to help you follow. So this is basically the little journey I will try to bring you through, taking it a little bit wide, so making some steps back in order to really see why this topic is so crucial for us today. My line of reasoning will be the following. To enforce, we need first of all a work. And let's assume you're talking about an audiovisual work. I work for the Audiovisual Observatory, so I think this is quite natural. And these are also particularly expensive to realize. So this work is produced by someone, but this someone does this professionally in order to make a living out of it. So I think this is something that we should never forget. And we need two preconditions in order to even reach this step: creativity and money. Once this is satisfied, then we can reach the stage where the work is produced. But in order to earn from it, of course, this author needs a certain degree of protection. And this is particularly important online because, as Christophe Geiger already mentioned, the dematerialization of the goods online makes this very easy. I'm sure we have some involuntary privates also in the room. It might be that we also ourselves have downloaded by accident a file and that we have been involuntary pirates or volunteer. I don't want to say that, but it's very easy. You can download, you can disseminate, you can distribute very easily. And that is also why it's not enough to have copyright rules, but we need to have copyright enforcement rules in order to ensure that these rules are being accomplished with. Otherwise, this is going to be a completely meaningless exercise. And only this way, this someone who produced this work can maybe produce another work and contribute to the growth of the audiovisual industry. And it's on the word growth that I would like now to make a small step back and to put this into a little bit wider context, which is the one of trust and regulation, and see why this is then so important. You might have seen this equation before. Opportunity plus trust, that gives us growth. And this is usually interpreted by media analysts into a wider cluster, which is called IT risk and resilience. I guess many of you have bumped into these types of analysis. Why is this important? Because it's important to build trust in order to ensure a level playing field between operators. Compliance with regulation is therefore important. But the problem here is that regulation can often be very complex. There might be overlaps, there might be gaps. And this can have a very negative repercussion on trust, which is very important in the digital world. Just think about privacy, e-commerce, fears that people might have when going online in general. So it's not only linked to copyright issues. And it's very important in order to allow this to happen that these specificities are being dealt with accurately in order to avoid these uncertainties. So let's now make this step back and get into the so-called medias res and see why all this is important for fostering creativity and also to start maybe from a false myth. We hear very often that copyright is a barrier. But I would like to tell you a little story in order to show you that this is not necessarily true. Copyright, it's not necessarily a restriction. And I'm sure you might recognize this guy here. That is Maurice Ravel. And I'm sure you have heard the bolero of Ravel, at least for an answering machine, I'm sure. I hope you have also listened to it in a concert hall. But I guess this is a quite familiar melody to many of you. Copyright, if you just take the word, is a right to copy. But it's also a restriction on the possibilities that we have to copy from one's work. Otherwise, we would infringe, of course, no copyright rules. And if copyright is a restriction, you could also think that it's something negative. But let's see what happened with Ravel. Very often, things start because a woman wishes something. And that was also the case here. It started with a dancer. Ida Rubinstein, she wanted a special music, and she asked Ravel to compose something very special for her, which was a reorchestration of another piece of music that had been written by another composer. And this rewriting, what was the problem with that? Isaac Albeniz had written a suite for piano, but he had given away the orchestration rights. So Ravel could not do this. He got very upset, and of course his main concern was his woman, which wish he wanted to satisfy. And he said that copyright rules, they were idiotic. That was his way of defining copyright rules, because he saw them as a restriction, as a barrier. In the meantime, poor Albeniz, well, he was even ready to waive his rights and say, well, go ahead, please orchestrate these rights and my melody. But then Ravel decided to do it his way. In the end, he was not even happy. He said that, and I'm reading here, je retiens le boléro comme la plus insolente monstruosité jamais perpétrée dans l'histoire de la musique. That was his opinion of his own bolero. And if you just consider that in terms of collective rights until from 1960, 50 million euros has been collected on this piece of music, you can also imagine that, well, it was something that was also very important in terms of growth. So what do we learn from this? Growth is seen, as we saw, as a combination of opportunity and trust, but restrictions, as a copyright regulation might look like, can also really foster creativity. Thanks to this, well, he did not benefit from it only, but there was a big legal battle on his rights, but it really shows that you can make a lot of positivity out of copyright rules. So this was the first myth, that copyright rules are not necessarily a restriction, but they can also be an opportunity. There is also another myth, that is that territoriality is also an obstacle, but this is also something very negative, and we are hearing a lot about territoriality these days. Why is this important and connected to our topic? Because enforcement online is usually made necessary because people argue that infringements online are almost unavoidable because the works are not available, because territoriality built a wall and does not respond to the needs of the digital single market, where everything should be available for everyone in any place. But why is all this like that? Well, copyright is born as a national creature. It works on a national basis. This means that rights holders, they can grant licenses on a geographical level, which doesn't mean that they have to do it just in one country. They are absolutely free to negotiate their rights in many countries and make the works available everywhere. But this is, of course, their legitimate choice in terms of being a business model. And the film industry in particular is very much based on this principle, because this is linked to the other aspect I mentioned, money. That's how the works are financed. And when I started saying that the someone that creates a work who wishes protection, he also deserves money for what he has produced, and in order to make that sure, enforcement is necessary. And this has been recognized, the principle of territoriality, by the courts, the European Court of Justice. It was just one case where this was not considered. That was a case of the Premier League, but that was sport area, which is a bit different. But if you have a look at the system of public aids, presets of rights, all this responds to an area characterized by territoriality. And this is also now to be seen in the copyright package. We will hear about this later on, more connected to the only article I will not mention, because I know both Christophe and Yuri Rida will mention Article 13, so at least I will avoid duplications in this regard. Digital single market and territoriality and copyright, these are also seen as clashes, but there are some accompanying measures. The copyright package is an enormous package if you want to dive into all of it. But if we just select a few items, you will see that from the December package, you have a very interesting measure, which is the one on portability. It's not yet approved, the regulation is still completing its adoption process. But this, of course, is not for pirates. This is for people who consume legally their offers and who want to continue benefit from viewing their content also when they travel around Europe. So this is a tool that somehow softens down the possible wall effect of territoriality. But a couple of months ago, the another package was presented that was a really big one, the corporate package, and there were also two interesting tools there. Rules on online access to content. It's a little bit limited because it concerns only ancillary online services, that is catch-up services, enriching services, expanding services, so it's not very wide, and it's also to be seen how this can be interpreted concretely. But it is certainly an interesting measure to be seen as an accompanying measure to the issue of territoriality. And then there is another measure which is also interesting, and these are the new negotiation mechanisms for licensing of video on demand, that is catalogs with content available on demand online. And in the light of this, we can maybe also conclude that commercial practices that are based on territoriality, they are not necessarily an obstacle. You need to put all this into context and into a specific perspective. So speaking about perspective, all this was about circulation in order to see why there is a problem of enforcement. The infringements are there because the works are not available, okay? But let's see, let's say they are available or people find the work that is not legally available. What happens then? There is a need of adequate protection tools, which are enforcement tools. Because it is a matter of fact that not everyone respects copyright, and that probably we will never have a world where there will be no violation, as we will never have a world where there will be no thieves. So we need enforcement tools against infringers, and this especially because digital technologies makes it very easy to perpetrate the violations of copyright tools. If we have a look at European legislation in this field, this has been quite criticized. The enforcement directive is quite old, it's from 2004. It's been working on a very, very limited level of harmonization because this is, of course, very much linked to the sovereignty of the member states. So when it comes to justice, this is, of course, a special pillar where there are big restrictions to possibilities of reducing member state sovereignty. But the main criticisms are probably the two that you see now on the screen. First one is that there have been many diverse interpretations and application practices of this directive in the member states, which sometimes can lead to uncertainties on what is allowed and what is not allowed, how far you can go, and which remedies can be put in place. And the other aspect is linked to other pieces of legislation, because not everything is connected to the enforcement directive. We have also the e-commerce directive, and I'm sure Christophe will tell a lot about that, so I will not preempt you. I had a preview at your slides, so I know you will entertain us about that. But the problem here is that not all member states, they have principles in the same way. The same concerns also the laws on data protection and the ways that you can act against the possible infringers. And then we have, of course, Article 13, but it's very likely that there will be a separate proposal on enforcement aspects. So what happened then in the meantime? Nationally, most member states, they have started to develop their own systems. Some of them have been quite creative. For example, you have countries that have opted for setting up new public authorities with special powers. That has been the case in France. In the case of Spain, you have ADUP in France, it's a quite complex history, I'm sure you are familiar with it, all of you, so we'll not go into details there. But it's been a very interesting case in terms of how to set up new powers and new institutions. You have other countries as Italy and the UK, where the regulatory authorities, they have been entrusted with special powers connected to enforcement online. That is the case of AGCOM, and in the UK, the Intellectual Property Office has been in touch with Ofcom. It came a little bit to a dead end, but it was at least a very interesting attempt of setting up new type of powers in this regard. But it must not be forgotten that there have also been many fights. There has been lots of protests from civil society. There have been judgments of constitutional courts, and that has happened both in France and in Italy and in Spain. So we are certainly on an area where the topics are also a bit itchy and sensitive. It's not only this. There have also been many spontaneous initiatives from the content industry. Let's just think about a tool called Follow the Money. I'm sure you're familiar with that. So this system, this approach that is aimed at draining the resources away from the illegal websites. That's a sort of voluntary enforcement tool where all the diverse intermediaries are involved. So here we're not talking only about information society providers as carriers or the ISPs as we know them, but especially advertisers, the payment providers, and they are in the way put into the magnifier lens and involved in this picture. Another voluntary system that is inspired from the Digital Millennium Copyright Act, which you of course also are familiar with, maybe because you've used it even, that's the notification takedown system, which allows a notification procedure where the consumers themselves can interact directly with the website in order to have an illegal content, where the rights holder, can interact directly with the websites and ask them to remove the content. But then you have another aspect, which is, of course, the more positive side of the coin. Availability of legal offers at interesting prices. There is always a level of tolerance of what people are willing to afford and to spend. Of course, you have always a certain part of the population who wants to spend zero, but I would say we leave them a little bit on the side. But there might be a level where prices can become interesting, and then piracy becomes a less attractive option. But there is also a lot to do on the matter of creating awareness. Many violations are often not voluntarily done. There is often a lack of knowledge among the users. And here I think media education can be a very interesting tool in order to also empower the users with the appropriate tools. So just to wrap up, which key messages I would like to leave you here on the copyright rules? Well, the first thing I think we can certainly all agree on is that copyright rules alone, they don't work. We need enforcement tool in order to make them work. And another aspect which is important is that these rules, they have to be easy to understand and easy to comply with. Otherwise, you don't create the precondition for trust, which was the one I mentioned in the beginning, which is crucial in order to allow for growth. And then that copyright should also not be seen as a restriction, as an obstacle. I think the story of Pavel, which might help you maybe remember this message, shows us really that this is not necessarily true. And should you need more inspiration, I would say you could go to our website. There are two nice publications that are available for free. One is specifically devoted to copyright enforcement policies and mechanism, and the other one concerns territoriality issues, which might be helpful in order to set the scene into context. Thank you very much.
Very much, Maja. And I assume that if there was anybody in the room before who had doubt whether this is an issue that could fill not only this afternoon but much more, I think those people are now converted. And there is a lot we can and should discuss. Even so, today we have certainly a specific focus later also on online world. And internet service providers, but right now we're still staying broad and we're continuing on where Maja has alluded to, namely the field of European legislation. And we have seen in the past months, we have seen the communication from the Commission, their action plan, we have seen draft regulation concerning portability, we have seen the draft copyright directive, and now we see, and even more important, we listen to a person who has been quite crucial also in telling the European Commission what the Parliament thinks should be maybe put in all of their work. And here I'm referring to Mr. Svoboda, as a parliamentarian and chair of the Committee on Legal Affairs, and has, before the Commission released their EU action plan, he has prepared the motion for European Parliament resolution on towards a renewed consensus on the enforcement of IP property rights. And I'm sure we will hear of this motion, but maybe also of other ideas and whatever has happened since. So the floor is yours, Mr. Svoboda.
thank you very much for the floor. Ladies and gentlemen, I must say at the very outset that it is very touching for me to be in these premises because I had the honor of serving as Czech ambassador to the Council of Europe some 8 years ago. So I'm really, really touched by the possibility to speak here to you today in this hall. First of all, I would like to thank the Center for International Intellectual Property Studies of the University of Strasbourg and the European Audiovisual Observatory of the Council of Europe for having invited me as the chair of the Legal Affairs Committee of the European Parliament, which in the Parliament is competent for intellectual property issues. The proposed topic for discussion is, in my view, one of the key issues of the reform, namely the copyright package that I will be speaking about. I think that there will be an interesting discussion afterwards. I have been asked to present the European Parliament's approach to the reform of copyright and its implications for copyright enforcement online. As you can imagine, this is not really an easy task. Different views exist in Parliament, and it is premature to present something like an approach of the European Parliament when the Parliament has not adopted any decision on the package. The legislative process in Parliament has only started, and the proposed reform will be debated intensively in our committee during the coming months. But the position that Parliament adopted in previous decisions on copyright and on IPR enforcement can give an idea of what can be expected in the forthcoming debate. The discussion on the reform was launched almost a year ago with a communication and a first legislative proposal on portability, as already mentioned by Mrs. Cappello. As far as the package that the Commission came up with in September is concerned, the approach in Parliament will not be the same for the four proposals. Mr. Anderson, who is our rapporteur on the two proposals implementing the Marrakesh Treaty, wants to progress quickly. This is in line with Parliament's position in favor of swift ratification of the Marrakesh Treaty. I hope we know basically what we are speaking about when I use the abbreviation Marrakesh Treaty. It's about access to copyrighted works by visually impaired, and we all feel that there is no time to waste, and we should facilitate access, namely to books, for these visually impaired persons. The proposals for a directive on copyright and for a regulation completing the cable and satellite directive are of different nature. More time will be needed to assess the measures proposed by the Commission. Both rapporteurs, Mrs. Comodini-Caccia, who is rapporteur for the directive, and Mr. Köster, who is in charge of the regulation, have decided to hold a first exchange of views in our committee only in January, after having consulted and heard all the interested stakeholders. It is therefore too early to present Parliament's position on this package. However, the Parliament elected in 2014 has been preparing for the last 2 years ahead of the publication of the proposed reform. In 2015, the Parliament adopted two resolutions on the InfoSoc Directive and on the Action Plan on IPR Enforcement, respectively. Discussions that have taken place in the JURI Committee, that's the abbreviation for the Legal Affairs Committee, and in the working group on IPR and copyright reform can also give us an idea what Parliament's approach is likely to be. The package proposed by the Commission is intended to adapt EU copyright legislation to the digital environment and to the new uses to which it has given rise. It aims at facilitating rights clearance for broadcasters who develop transmissions of TV and radio programs online. It creates a new ancillary right for press publishers and new mandatory exceptions or limitations to copyright for certain uses. The proposed legislation also aims to facilitate licensing and to ensure the functioning of the licensing agreements concluded between online service providers and right holders. I think that this is one of the central elements of the proposal and that it should be assessed very carefully. The Commission proposes to create an obligation for online service providers who store and give access to the public of large amounts of copyright-protected works uploaded by their users to take appropriate measures to ensure the protection of the works. The Commission specifies that these measures should be effective content recognition technologies. In other words, big players like YouTube should carry on using their in-house content recognition technology, and those who have not used any will have to start purchasing such technology outside. How should this measure be implemented? To the question whether intermediary service providers should play a role in enforcing copyright online, the Commission seems to reply positively. Does this mean that the Commission considers that the role of online services should be limited to using content recognition technologies? And what is the Parliament's approach to this? The result of the Commission's public consultation show that member states and rights holders consider that online services should play an important role, contrary to intermediaries and citizens. We can expect some discussions in Parliament here. However, we must draw attention to the fact that the respondents from civil society were largely from Germany, and therefore the citizens' reply should be interpreted rather carefully as it could express a national specificity. The Parliament has expressed the wish to consider solutions for the displacement of value from content to services. It also underlined the need to adjust the definition of the status of intermediary in the current digital environment and the need for precise detection systems that lead to the swift interruption of commercial scale infringing activities. The inclusion of online actors in measures to combat IPR infringements must nonetheless comply with the principles of the Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union. We can expect a majority of members of the European Parliament, in my view, to welcome the idea of involving the big players of the internet in copyright enforcement by monitoring the content uploaded by their users. At least I hope so. However, the Commission's proposal raises at least two questions. First, the question of the effectiveness or usefulness of such a proposal. To what extent will the technology be sufficient to put an end to copyright infringement online and prevent infringers from finding new ways to circumvent the rules? Secondly, is this proposed measure reviewing the liability regime of the e-commerce directive without formally reopening the directive? Alternatively, does it mean that the role of online service providers in copyright enforcement online should be limited to the use of content recognition technologies? As far as Parliament is concerned, this should perhaps go further. As stated in its resolution on the InfoSoc Directive, there is a need to review the liability of service providers and intermediaries in order to clarify their legal status and liability with regard to copyright. However, the Commission maintains the liability regime of online intermediaries established by the e-commerce directive. Beyond the role of online service providers, the question now is, can we ensure copyright enforcement online? And if so, how? In its resolution of 2015 on the action plan on copyright enforcement, Parliament very much supported the Commission's vision of enhancing voluntary cooperation between rights holders and the actors of the internet. However, Parliament also stressed the need to develop the legislative side. Improving prevention is considered important, but tackling infringement through imperative rules is also considered necessary by the Parliament. Is the IPR Enforcement Directive of 2004 in some respects out of step with the digital age and insufficient for combating online infringements? That's another question. Parliament is waiting for a detailed assessment of the limitations of the current legal framework as regards online activities. If appropriate, Parliament considers that the legal framework should be adapted to the internet environment. It appears that the directive has not been implemented in a uniform way across the EU and that divergent interpretations of certain provisions of the directive result in differences in its application in the member states. This has been mentioned already by Mrs. Cappello. This fragmentation creates litigation problems in cross-border situations. Parliament has called on the Commission to take action to remedy the problems identified, including by means of further clarification of the directive. Other issues to be assessed relate to the possibility to adjust the rules for provisional and precautionary measures for injunctions and criminal sanctions. Parliament will have to discuss whether the copyright reform should also include a formal notice and takedown procedure. In conclusion, the Parliament believes that copyright is only as effective as the enforcement measures in place to protect it. Copyright enforcement must therefore be robust. There is a need for a comprehensive legal framework to combat infringement adapted to the online environment. Copyright enforcement online should be envisaged as a package, and all the issues at stake should be considered. Precautionary measures, the development of legal offers, the application of e-commerce framework, technological development, and the disparities between the national systems of criminal sanctions. We may regret that the copyright reform as presented by the Commission looks piecemeal, and moreover, part of it is still to come if we consider the forthcoming IPRED review. That's as the enforcement directive. There is no doubt that this reform will be intensively discussed in the parliament in the months to come. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Mr. Svoboda, for this insight in the work of the parliament, which we actually way too rarely get. It's much appreciated. I think that's very important to have the opportunity to hear firsthand what's going on, what are concerns. And we have now also the opportunity to actually really ask questions to both people who presented their views, their work. I want to give a little note of caution. You might have already realized this. We are waiting for Commissioner Ansip, who is announced for around 3:10. But I do think this leaves us ample of time still for questions. And maybe I really look immediately to the floor to give you as much opportunity as possible to bring those questions to our two presenters. So if there is anybody who wants to take the floor, please give sign. So you, okay, in the back.
Sorry,
and I would appreciate if you were to introduce yourself and before you have a question.
Un peu, voilà. Donc, Patrick Braquer de Strasbourg, je suis un ancien inventeur indépendant et un ancien membre de l'Association des inventeurs et des fabricants d'Alsace, qui était fédérée par la Fédération nationale des associations françaises d'inventeurs, et même fédérée par l'Association européenne des inventeurs. Donc j'ai simplement une question par rapport à l'articulation possible des travaux du Parlement européen par rapport à cette mise en place du droit. Sur l'articulation avec l'Office mondial de la propriété intellectuelle à Genève, et aussi l'articulation avec les États-Unis et la réalité. Voilà.
Okay, I think the question went straight to you, Mr. Svoboda, if you want to answer it, or if not, you can also collect first other questions. You would?
Thank you. Only I would say, I'm looking at Mrs. Reda whether she has better information, but only to a very small small degree. Obviously, people are in contact with the institutions mentioned, but we are obviously focused on the inside of the EU institutions and states, but we do have contacts and we let's say to a certain degree talk to institutions outside the EU.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. There's another question.
Yes, hello, my name is Delfi. I represent the Motion Picture Association based in Brussels. I have a question for Pavel Svoboda. Sorry, that's the pronunciation. You mentioned the lack of harmonization or the disparities in criminal sanctions. That is something that, if I understand correctly, that the Parliament is looking at. Could you elaborate on that a little bit? Maybe I misunderstood your comments in that regard, but I'm curious about it because when the enforcement directive was drafted in 2004 era, the harmonization of criminal sanctions was dropped ultimately, as you will be well aware. So I'm curious to know a little bit more.
I think you understood quite well. It was rather a sigh, a comment, because the problem of this is linked to the fact that EU as a whole does not have competencies in the criminal law, so anything that should be considered in this area would respect, to be done on the EU level, would respect transfer, in effect, transfer of competencies from the member states, which I do not see in the nearest future as realistic.
Maybe we have one short question still to have our commissioner settle in. Give him a chance. It's still priest. Is there one short question still? Yes, please.
Good evening. My name is Evangelia Loli. I am a master's student of CEIPI, and I would like to address a question to Mrs. Maja Cappello. As you already noticed, the adequate mix of legislation and enforcement measures is the key for the solution of copyright enforcement. And I have a concern because I read the public the results of the public consultations for the enforcement directive, and I noticed that many citizens believe that the problem is not the enforcement but the substantive law. They call for a review and harmonization, for example, on the exception and limitations, on the copyright protection, that it should be on a shorter term and not that long. In other words, my question is, if you think that the lack of knowledge is that will drive us to the enforcement, and how can we reach the element of social approvement? Because this is what I think is the problem. If society doesn't approve the rules, enforcement can do what in this case? Thank you.
Good point. It's always an issue of balancing of interest, that's clear, and that's also what is behind all the rationale of exceptions. So rights holders, they go on to a certain stage with the economic side of the rules, and then there is, of course, the rights of the end users to benefit from the works of other people, and the exceptions as such, they are, of course, conceived as exceptions, which means they have to be interpreted restrictively. That is a general principle of law that applies to any type of exception in any sector. So this is, of course, nothing peculiar for copyright. But indeed, social acceptance is crucial because as from ancient Roman law for the consuetudo, that law became law only when people thought it was a law. So this is, of course, true also for copyright rules. I think awareness creation in this regard can play a very important and interesting role, not only for issues as copyright, but also in general other issues that concern the internet as responsibilities of the big platforms, for example, not only for copyright, but also hate speech, violence, protection of minors. It's really a wider issue. So again, sorry for lifting up the ball, but many of these problems, they are not only copyright related. Awareness can in this regard be important because rules, if they are properly explained and if they are easy to understand, I think we can go quite far. Substantial rules are now in the copyright package for the reform, so indeed there has been a step in that part, not yet on the enforcement package, apart from this Article 13 and all the discussions that are around that part. I don't see very much on the chapter awareness creation and work with consumers. This is something that it's left a little bit up to the member states. We have been, as Observatory, almost finalized a study now on media literacy around the EU 28, not specifically on copyright, but of course this falls into the same cluster. And there is a very wide and scattered picture. You have the digitally advanced countries that do a lot. That is the case, for example, of the Baltic countries, also the UK has done really a lot, Germany as well. Then you have other countries that are a little bit more, let's lower. And that's also, and this is maybe not a coincidence, the countries where the rates of infringements are particularly high. So I would say, do you have a point there? They should really go hand in hand. Yeah.
So thank you. That brings us in a way back to we having put things in context. We have heard from the Parliament the view and a bit the eagerness to go even further than what is currently proposed. And that leads us to the person, the leader of the project team Digital Single Market, Vice President of the Commission, Mr. Ansip. We're very pleased to have you here and to share with us your views on the enforcement of copyright in an online world. And I want to take liberty to read from your mission letter that you got when you were appointed from Mr. The President Juncker, which I do not know whether you memorized this by heart, but I think it is quite already marking your steps. You were asked to steering and coordinating within the first 6 months of the mandate ambitious legislative steps towards a connected digital single market, notably by adding more ambition to modernizing copyright rules in the light of the ongoing digital revolution, taking full account of Europe's rich cultural diversity and modernizing and simplifying consumer rules for online and digital purchases. I stop here and the word is yours.
Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to thank the University of Strasbourg and the European Council for organizing this event here. I was asked by organizers to prepare a speech, and I have this speech. But I see format is much better for Q&As. So but let's do it in this way, that the first I will deliver this speech and then I'm ready to take your questions. So, ladies and gentlemen, Daria Fo, the Nobel Prize winning playwright and actor who died last month, put a high value on European culture. He said, arts, literature, literature, music are the connecting links of Europe. Culture does connect us. It comes from many different people. It can be exercised in many different ways. It promotes social inclusion. It supports cultural diversity. Diversity is something Europe has in abundance across the cultural spectrum. We are home to an amazing amount of ideas, talent and creativity, world-class artists, creators, and the industry that supports them in their work. At the same time, there is a dark cloud lurking, piracy. A while ago, I saw an article that described piracy as a quiet killer slowly suffocating Europe's cultural industries. It is a correct description. Piracy is certainly damaging our creative industries, devouring their revenues, destroying people's jobs, despite the huge rise in online video and music services, and despite the abundance of cultural richness and diversity I just mentioned. Piracy also costs the European economy billions of euros every year. Let me put that into context. Estimates vary, but we are looking at nearly 7 million jobs provided by our cultural and creative sectors, mostly in small businesses, and 4% of GDP. Piracy is diverse. It takes different forms to achieve the same results, usually to get something for free. As technologies evolve and the world goes increasingly digital, so does piracy. Overall, who loses out? Everybody does, even customers. But it is creators who are first in line. We all know that piracy is not a new problem. So what we are doing about it? The first line of attack is also one of necessity, to adapt today's copyright rules to today's digital reality and make legal content more available. We know digital technologies have transformed people's behavior and habits. You only have to look at the rise of smartphones and tablets. How most people today view and enjoy material, news, film, music, or books. Consumer demands and wishes are very different compared with 10 years ago. Our rules need to reflect these new and emerging online uses. This is why we started our copyright reform late last year with a proposal to allow subscribers to online content services in one EU country to use those services when they are temporarily present in another. How does that help to fight piracy? If cross-border access to online content is improved and expanded, then people gain a legal alternative to illegal downloads. Inevitably, these will continue up to a point. But with more legal content available also across EU borders, we can certainly reduce them. People will have fewer reasons to resort to piracy or use gray area technologies like VPN, as they are encouraged to pay for content. Ultimately, this is what we all want. It worries me when I see studies showing that nearly 60% of viewers admit to getting films online for free. A significant share of this is pirated, or that a quarter of young people in the European Union use illegal sources to access online material. Even more, 42% of Europeans overall say they think that doing this is acceptable for personal use. They all have different reasons for doing so, but all of it is done intentionally. Something has to change. Attitudes and habits need to change. We need to get people back on track to pay for the content. It will not happen overnight. We can start by toughening the rules and making sure they are enforced. Otherwise, we are fighting a losing battle. Artistic rights that cannot be effectively enforced have little economic value. We have to be tough on this. That is why we are also tackling piracy with a follow the money process with industry, working with big brands and advertising professionals to hit the pirates where it hurts, their revenues. We want to deprive commercial scale infringers of revenues to cut the financial flows to businesses that make money out of piracy. We want to cover the entire industry spectrum, to broker agreements with platforms and companies, payment providers, transport operators. We started in June with an agreement that focuses on counterfeit goods sold online. It covers internet sales platforms as well as brands across the vast spectrum of consumer goods, electronics, fashion and film, luxury and sports goods. This is self-regulation. However, I want to stress my firm belief that it is everyone's interest to make it work, because everyone is at risk. We are all involved in a common fight against a common threat. Those signing up are subject to strict monitoring based on several key indicators that will act as a real follow-up mechanism. Provisions include take-down procedures, but also proactive measures that platforms can take against the offers of goods that are clearly pirated. This is a necessary step in the European Commission's campaign to tackle internet piracy. We expect to sign the second agreement next year, this time with the advertising industry. It will help to restrict the income that intellectual property infringing websites get from online advertising. More of these initiatives are in the pipeline. For example, we are now in discussions with payment service providers and logistics companies. Finally, as you know, the EU already has a law to enforce intellectual property rights. This law does not only cover copyright, but also other intellectual property rights such as trademarks and designs. Since it dates from 2004, we are checking that it fully reflects developments in the digital environment and the increasingly cross-border nature of intellectual property rights violations. I'm aware this is a sensitive area, so we will need a delicate balance based on strong evidence. That is why we are now analyzing views from all parties involved to understand properly what is working in the current setup and what is not. Ladies and gentlemen, on piracy, like counterfeiting, is more than a serious online piracy, like counterfeiting, is more than a serious headache. It is a global problem that we take very seriously. It goes beyond Europe, of course. Commercial scale intellectual property infringements are becoming far more frequent and organized worldwide. Even if the vast majority of e-commerce that is carried out on the major internet platforms is legitimate, these platforms can also be abused. It is time now to stop the abuse, stop the extra cost to industry and business, and stop this pervasive threat to Europe's cultural fabric. We can best achieve that by working together to update and enforce the rules. By winning the fight against piracy, we also reward and stimulate the originality and creativity that made artistic champions like Dario Fo value European culture so highly. Thank you.
Thank you very much for these quite clear, I would say, words, and even more for your initial proposal to use this informal setting, this round table setting, to accept questions. And I think this is a great opportunity which I would like to pass on, selfishness, as I try to be. So, who would like to pose a question to Commissioner Ansip and to the ideas that he has just explained to us, how the Commission sees the way to combat piracy? I know there is a person. And please introduce yourself.
I'm Marco Pollero, for just on the sidelines of what the Commissioner yourself highlighted. Thank you for being here. As President, you know very well that your friend Juncker, Jean-Claude had also wrote a book about a report famous about the cooperation between the European Union and Council of Europe, where the Observatory is a member. And by coincidence, at this moment, it's okay? By coincidence, at this moment, this day, this very day that you are here, there was also a program for the next months to come, the next year, from the Council of Europe, the Committee of Ministers that was announced, about the protection of culture and mainly of your book and cultural heritage also. And since the digital aspect and from the copyright point of view, since the digital aspect and from the copyright point of view and from the point of view of the common market is very important in order to promote also and protect and promote the culture and cultural heritage, which was the most special for the Council of Europe. Could you kindly tell us what might be your ideas or how what could be the origin about this coincidence between the culture, digital, single market, copyright, and cultural heritage also? Don't you think that Europe has a potential that could be and protected and promoted in this direction? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this very complex question. I think the whole idea of digital single market is mentioned to protect our cultural heritage, to improve access to those masterpieces by created by creators, and I hope everybody will benefit. As you know, our aim is to provide better access to digital content to our citizens, and at the same time our aim is also to provide fair remuneration to our authors. So, and I cannot see contradiction between those two aims. Last December, or let's say last May, we launched this digital single market strategy. And on basis of those 16 aims, we started to launch our proposals already last December. And one of those very first proposals was about the low portability of the content. As we know today, 20% of European citizens are spending at least 10 days during the year in another country. And many of those people traveling somewhere in other EU member states, they would like to get access to their legally bought digital content in their home countries. But because of copyright restrictions, they cannot. As we know, for ordinary people, it's not a big problem. VPN is available. So 20% of internet users in the European Union are using VPN to get access to digital content. And VPN is not free of charge. You have to pay 6, 8, 10 euros per month, 20 euros per 3 months. And if paid, you don't think you're doing something in the wrong way. But there is a big problem. Authors are not remunerated. Even 68% of film viewers in the European Union said that they are using so-called free downloads. Once again, authors are not remunerated. And this is a problem. So, somehow, I said it many, many times, that with our regulations, we are pushing our people for those so-called free downloads or usage of VPN. We had to tackle piracy, but at first we had to provide also legal access to digital content to our people. So, this was about portability of the content. We will protect the principle of territoriality, but for me it's very difficult to understand when people they are asking for absolute territorial exclusivity. So is it really absolute territorial exclusivity when 20% of the internet users are using VPN to get access to digital content and 68% of film viewers are using free downloads? My understanding about absolute exclusivity is different. Absolute, it means 0% or 100%, but this understanding about absolute exclusivity is quite relative, 20%, 68%. So, this was our very first proposal. Then, when we launched a couple of months ago our second copyright reform package, we decided to deal also especially with preservation of our cultural heritage. So we proposed mandatory harmonized exception for preservation purposes by cultural heritage institutions. So in museums, in archives today, for example, if you would like to to change one carrier into another, for example, VHS to DVD, and then licensing is a really big challenge. And administrative costs of licensing, that they are enormously high level. So we would like to cut those administrative costs and then to provide to all people access to those masterpieces created by creators. Cultural heritage is a great value, but it will be much better when this cultural heritage will be not locked in archives or museums, when people they will get access to our cultural heritage. So we proposed also to extend the usage of country of origin principle. We proposed also to extend the usage of collective licensing model, and the aim is to at least double the volume of the content which will be available cross-border by our citizens. I think everybody will benefit if we will be able to reach those aims, both creators and our citizens. So, lot of other proposals were made. It's also somehow cultural heritage when we're talking about the fair remuneration of our authors. So if they will be not fairly remunerated, then with no demand, then nobody will provide some real masterpieces. So value gap is so. Some people they are very familiar with this issue of musicians, for example. They are unhappy. They say that they are not fairly remunerated. They are complaining on platforms. And looking on those platforms, we can see that there are different platforms. Platforms based on subscription. Subscriptions, so they have 68 million users per month, and those platforms are contributing to 2 billion years to musicians. At the same time, there are some other platforms supported by advertising, and those platforms they have near to 1 billion users per month, but they are contributing just 643 million years to musicians. And of course, musicians, they are unhappy. They say there is value gap. So 68 million and 2 billion years, 1 billion and just 0.6 billion years. So we promised when we started to act as a new commission to make it more clear. When platforms they are acting as neutral intermediaries, and from where we have to say that they are selling new value-added product, but without remuneration. So today, some platforms, maybe those supported by advertising, they say that we don't know what is happening there in our platforms because we are just neutral intermediaries. So there is a need to make it more clear when they are real neutral intermediaries and when they are selling new value-added product using somebody else's work, but without remuneration. So we propose to use some technical tools to improve the situation. We'd like to promote this content recognition instrument. As we know, they are using already content recognition due to, for example, it was quite expensive. They paid more than 60 million euros to create this tool, but now they say that they are able to recognize 95% from all the uploads, and they are asking from authors, would you like to monetize this content, or would you like to ask us to take out this content? And 90% of people, they say, we would like to monetize this content. So trend is quite cool already. But YouTube and Content ID is not the only tool available. Audible, time is over. Audible Magic, for example, providing the same type of services, and I think it's not so expensive if to identify 10,000 songs, you have to pay somewhere 400 euros. So once again, both of those aims: to provide better access to our people to digital content, and to provide fair remuneration to our authors. Those both aims, they are really important for this commission. Thank you.
I'm a master's student at Sciences Po in Strasbourg, and I did my dissertation about the digital market and focusing about the data protection. I was actually wondering, what are you planning to do with the European countries who refuse the recent regulation about geo-blocking in order to protect their local and national artists from copyright enforcements?
Yeah, you opened another discussion for hours and hours. So geo-blocking is a real headache for everybody, I think. I'm talking about unjustified geo-blocking. Everybody faced, I think, here in this room, unjustified geo-blocking. Sorry, this video is not available in your country. You know, we all know what does it mean. But talking about physical goods, the same story. We organized a so-called mystery shopping survey in the Commission, and according to those results, picture is not so nice at all in the European Union. So 2% of those people who wanted to buy some goods and services from another EU member states, they couldn't get access to those websites because their IP address was wrong. They were from wrong country. 2%, let's say, not so many people. Why we have to deal with those issues? But 27% of those people who got access to websites, they couldn't register it because their IP address was wrong. They were from wrong countries. 32% of those people who were able to register it, they faced with delivery problems. And those are natural problems, and to find solution for those problems, we made our parcel delivery proposal. Because those parcel delivery prices in the European Union, they're quite strange prices. The lowest cross-border parcel delivery price in the European Union, when talking about 2 kilograms parcels, is in Netherlands, 10 euros 50 cents. And difference between domestic prices and cross-border parcel delivery prices is also the lowest one in Netherlands, 1.6 times. But in one country, this difference is 22 times. If this is not the protectionist one, then I would like to know what this protection, the protectionist really is. And even 26% of those people who didn't have any kind of problems with delivery issues, they couldn't pay. We have CEIPI in the European Union, Single European Payments Area. But nevertheless, they said your credit cards was issued in wrong country. And they were not able to pay. All in all, only 36% of those people who wanted to buy some goods and services online from another country, they were able to conclude those purchases successfully. So I don't think it's It's about the single market we have to have in the European Union. So we, according to my understanding, this is a discrimination on basis of somebody's nationality or where his credit card was issued. And that's why I said many times, I hate geo-blocking. We have to abolish the unjustified geo-blocking. As you know, we decided to take this step-by-step approach, or salami approach, slice by slice. So it's practically impossible to get the toll already today or tomorrow. We have to take a step-by-step approach. And in the very beginning, we will deal with physical, tangible goods and services sold online but consumed locally, like hotel business, car rental, etc. Then we have to deal with music. But the scope of this proposal is copying the scope of e-commerce directive and visual is out of the scope. With the visual, audiovisual content, we have to deal with other proposals. But once again, nobody will really benefit from those barriers which are higher and higher dividing our member states of the 21st century in the European Union. We all benefited from this single market we were able to create in physical meaning already 20 years ago, but now we can see how those barriers, because of digitization, are coming back. It's much easier to control digital traffic than physical movements or goods and services. So, we will deal with those issues, but it will take some time. Thank you.
So time is the buzzword. I think our time is with us out. We thank you very much for the overtime, and we'll be very happy if you still have a minute to stay with us for the coffee break, which is awaiting us outside of the room. And I would be obliged if the participants could be back at 4 o'clock. So thank you.